Okay, so we're doing this presentation because all of you need to be familiar with how to identify appropriate assistive technology for people in the workforce. So the human assistive technology model has been developed by Cook and Hussey to think through in a very systematic way how to identify assistive technology that's going to make a difference and be used, because people with disabilities have very unique needs and it can be challenging to provide them technology that they actually use. There's a huge amount of assistive technology that's abandoned sitting in people's basements. When I go do assessments for workers with disabilities, quite often they say, oh, I have this out in my shed, or out in the woods I parked whatever, this wheelchair just didn't get me where I needed to go, so I don't use it anymore. So the human assistive technology model is a systematic way for us to try thinking through all the scenarios and situations a person might face so that we can recommend the best technology for them. This presentation is not going to talk about specific technology. It's talking about how to gather the necessary information so we can make proper recommendations. And we will do a later presentation on assistive technology. But right now we're thinking about how to identify it. So the human assistive technology model accounts for the human, the person who needs this, the activities that they need to do, and the context or the environment that they're going to be doing it in. So if we don't understand the human and the personal situation, both their physical abilities, their emotions, their cognitive situation, we're not going to recommend appropriate technology. If we don't understand the context or the environment, and we recommend something that fails if it gets wet and it's supposed to be used outside, we're not going to give them good technology. And if we don't think through the activities that this person's working on, we're not going to do a good job. So, first of all, think about the human. Physical. How strong are they? What is their range of motion? What body parts can they use well and control well, and what can they not? What is their emotional state? What is it that they like to do? What is it that gives them joy and purpose in life? Because we might have some really great assistive technology to help someone go out and weld together broken parts in the shop, but they might hate welding. But we got a really cool tool. Look what you could do with your welder. Maybe they have a cognitive impairment and it's not safe for them to use that welder. Maybe we have great assistive technology to help them get onto an ATV to go out and plow the snow, but they don't have the ability to respond and stop the ATV before they drive into the ditch or slide out into the road and get hit. So we really need to understand and evaluate not only the physical, but the cognitive and the emotional aspects of a person's life before we recommend the technology. So the context: extreme temperatures, dust, respiratory situations. If we don't ask about that and someone has asthma and then we go and help them get technology where they could clean out their rabbit hutches or something, but we don't address the respiratory side of it, and we're sending them into dusty or humid conditions that exacerbates their problem, we have to be careful. We don't recommend technology that's going to harm them in another way. So that's the part of the context that's easy for us to understand. The environment, the physical environment. Is it going to be hot? Is it going to be cold? Are there big bumps? Is there mud, dust? We can picture that. But the social aspects of What does her husband think about her going into that work environment? What about their children? What about their dad? So if I have an older worker call me and he wants to be able to get back out and operate his bulldozer again, but his sons, who are actually running the business, the last thing they want is their 80-year-old dad on that bulldozer ruining equipment and damaging property, we're going to fail. There was a situation where, in my assistive technology evaluation, I erred. We had developed a great plan for a worker to get an accessible pickup truck, a lift in, a way to stow the wheelchair in the back, a lift for him to get onto his tractor to be able to go out into his orchard and spray. He had a spinal cord injury. It was moving along. We even had the finances figured out. The funder was, everything was lined up. We had quotes from vendors. We had approved designs. And his wife lined up a farm sale and sold the tractor. She did not want him out. For concern for his safety, social concerns, there was situations there that didn't have anything to do with equipment. But as an assistive technology professional, we want to quickly jump to the equipment. And here's the solution, where the equipment wasn't the solution in that situation at that point. So we have to understand the social environment and the cultural environment. Coming from a dairy farm, if you aren't working 14 hours a day, you are a slacker and you're not doing your job. And if you don't get up by 5 in the morning, you need to figure something out and get there. So now a person has a medical impairment and they're dealing with this kind of pressure, whether it's perceived or real. It might be part of a culture that you had better be out there working. And so we need to understand that. And if we can take into account the assistive technology for the culture the person's working in, that maybe just having the person out there and present and helping them with mobility so that they don't use up all their energy in the first hour of the day just walking places, maybe the person is still mobile and they can get around with a cane, but it's taking up so much energy that they are unproductive for the rest of the day. So maybe that person gets a power scooter or wheelchair so that they can be part of the culture that they need to be in. So this is the context, the whole situation. What are the family finances? Are we going to recommend really amazing assistive technology that they have no hope of ever being able to purchase? And is that going to be productive for this person? So in our evaluation, in our conversation with the person with a disability, we try to understand, and we're going to spend a lot of time asking questions that the client maybe doesn't think are relevant. What does this have to do with my assistive technology, with me getting back to work? But it is relevant, and it comes back around when we get to the point of making a plan of what we're going to actually help them achieve. So here we have a context of a worker. Is he working alone? Is he working with a group of people? That's part of the social context also. And what is he doing here? And is it retail, personal use? But look at this picture and think about what are three things that you can observe about his context, about his environment, just from looking at this one picture.
He doesn't have like structured pathways between his raised gardens.
Okay.
So the terrain.
Shelter. He's not in the greenhouse.
He doesn't have shelter in this situation. Wide open spaces.
Toting his tools around could be challenging.
If we could zoom in on this picture, you would see that he has his clippers stuck in his boot. Because he has a prosthetic leg. And so it doesn't cause any blisters. He shoves his snips right down into his boot. But you're right.
He needs something bigger. What does he do?
Tools. Very good. So we have terrain, shelter. It's hard to tell what is his social environment. I can tell you that he works alone. There's no one else out there with him doing his farm work. And he sells the flowers at farmers markets. So that is his, some of his context. Here's another one. What do you observe in this scenario here? About his context.
He has pathways and shelter.
There is shelter from what?
Rain.
Rain?
Mm-hmm. Not heat.
Not heat. There's going to be some extreme temperatures in this.
He doesn't appear to have legs, which would, I think, impact how he uses the rest of his body.
Without legs to use, he's going to use his arms primarily to move through the environment. The pathways you mentioned that he has are rather tight, right? There's going to be some issues of maneuvering through this environment. But he's not dealing with mud and rough ground like the previous picture. And once again, the social context of this, he has a son that works with him full time. So what about reaching those top baskets?
I don't see how he does.
What's he going to do?
Yeah.
He'll need help.
He'll need help. So there is another worker with him. And so that's part of the context to understand. Okay, here's another one. What do you see in this environment?
Whoever has the disability has support, although we don't know which one that is.
The disability isn't apparent.
Now there's a cultural context that you just brought up, Bev. The disability is not apparent. In many of the cultures where a tradesman or a farmer is working, if you don't look handicapped, you aren't handicapped, and you don't need help. And how dare you go asking for help when I'm limping and you're not? And nobody has any idea from this picture which one of those individuals has a disability, but I can tell you it's very significant in several ways, but I'm not even going to tell you. But that is a very good observation of the culture. Neither one of them looks like they have a disability. Okay, there's other environmental observations we can make here.
Large area, so probably a need for large equipment.
Large wide open area, large field. This is probably not going to be worked with a hoe as much as with a tractor. So the equipment is gonna be different here. That's right. So now we move on from, we've thought about the human situation, the context that they're working in, now the activities that they have to do. This is one of the biggest challenges for a tradesperson, is the many, many things that they would do every day. From climbing to a ladder, to crawling down into a basement, to walking across an expanse of land, to reaching and picking if they're a farmer, or a plumber. loosening hose clamps or crimping a PEX tube, whatever the situation, what do we do when there's hundreds of activities and each of those activities could be broken down into three or four tasks? This is the situation that we're going to spend a lot of time with when we are thinking about assistive technology. What are the activities? Remember the person. Back to that social question of the human. What gets them out of bed in the morning? It becomes very important when we get to this stage of the activity and thinking about which activities are we going to accommodate. The context of the culture that they're in. Is it really important that I'm able to get on my tractor? That could be very important. Or the finances. What's the financial situation? Which activity is going to generate the most income? Well, maybe that's a question and maybe it's not, because the human that we're serving might want to work for quality of life, and income isn't the biggest challenge for them. See, when we get to the activity stage, it's very important that we understand the context and the human so that we can think about the best activities to accommodate. So here, on a market farm, we have a situation where carpal tunnel is very, very common. And there are so many activities at different times of the year that a person is going to need to do. Filling the flats with soil, seeding those flats, watering them, just holding the hose, adjusting the lights up and down, filling pots, transplanting the tiny little seedlings from the flats into the pots that will be taken to the field, carrying the pots to the field, operating the equipment, tilling, laying the plastic mulch, weeding, irrigation, spraying, controlling weeds, coming to the time of harvesting, not just picking it off, but knowing that it's ripe and in good enough condition you would want to pick it, getting it into the basket, carrying it in, packing it so that it looks nice after you've washed it, transporting it to market, sales, bookkeeping, and field cleanup, which I missed. I worked with a vegetable grower and helped him with everything, and I forgot about field cleanup. And when you lay plastic mulch to keep the weeds down so that you don't have to irrigate as much, and you can put your fertilizer, it's a wonderful accommodation, but it's a lot of work to pick that back up out of the field in the fall. And I had a farmer call me and say, what do I do now? Because his disability, he could not remove that mulch from the field. And so I had to scramble a little bit and figure out what are we going to do to help him. And he was able to buy a piece of equipment that helped him. So, multitudes of activities, which one are we going to accommodate? Let's think about how frequent does this have to be done. If it's something that happens 10,000 times, we better accommodate that. If it's something that happens 30 times, probably going to go down on the list, unless those 30 times are really major events, very culturally important, very financially important. If the other points are high, maybe we would accommodate something that's only done 30 times a year. If the danger aspect of it, okay, if you need to load a bull and he could kill you and you only do it a few times a year, it's probably worth accommodating and making a safe way to do that. The lowest cost way, if possible, is to eliminate it? Is that really necessary that you do it that way? So possibly instead of filling all of your flats and seeding all of your plants and doing all the transplanting into pots, maybe you contact a company who does that for a business and for not a whole lot of more money than what it costs you to do it yourself, you could purchase your plants already seeded and started and ready to go to your transplanter. Or you could trade it with other workers on the farm. Here's the social aspect. Are you working alone or do you have someone to trade with? And how easy is it to accommodate? If there's 50 activities that you want to be able to do, but only 10 of them are you going to be able to get to in a reasonable amount of time? Let's pick the 10 that can be accommodated easiest, if possible. So, we have a whole survey of questions to go through. And you're familiar with this, perhaps. But this just helps us when we are having a conversation with a person with a disability to gather everything. And it might seem laborious to go through and use this survey. And it might seem to the person with a disability, like, why are you asking me all these questions? But we've already gone through the point of it. And so we're just going to look at a few slides here. Personal data here. Is this the person? Is this the context? Is this the activity? In general, we're looking here, let's understand the human being. Let's get the big picture of when they tell us their story. They're going to tell us first what hurts the most. And second, when they're telling us their story, we're going to hear from them what's really important. So this first page, when we're taking their call and their information and just let them talk for 5 minutes, it's going to help us get a little bit of window into their psyche, because the most important things to them are going to come to the top. And that's not going to be the only thing we use to decide the assistive technology, but it is very significant and helps us understand a lot of the culture that they're in and their real situation. Then we can ask more detailed questions from their doctor's report. Do you have lifting restrictions? Have you been told by a medical professional to not do something? Because to do a good job with our assistive technology, we need to know our limits, that we are not medical doctors, we are not therapists. We know about assistive technology, but we need to let people in those professions do their part. Has this person reached maximum medical improvement? Should we recommend a $10,000 assistive technology item that'll be obsolete in a year because this person's expected to regain some function through therapy? It doesn't mean we have to wait on all the assistive technology, because for that year, there's probably ways that we can help them. That's part of the context, is how long do you need this? So, gathering that information about the medical situation is very important for us to understand the human. The caregivers, who's involved in this person's life, because if a person with a disability has lots of support or no support, do they need help in the home? Are they able to get up and get dressed and brush their teeth so they can go to work? We might need to start there, even before we get to the work site. It may be a situation that we aren't familiar with. We can make referrals to independent living centers, disability network organizations that can provide some of the home aids to daily living. Our specialty and what we are really looking at here is the productivity, the profession, the employment type activities. There are very many organizations that help with assistive technology for daily living, aids for daily living. There's a lot of organizations, say Mary Free Bed Hospital, for instance, here in Grand Rapids, they have adaptive sports of all sorts. Downhill skiing, hockey, basketball, rugby, sailing. You can go to clinics and learn about adaptive leisure, assistive technology for leisure. What we are really honing in on here is assistive technology for productivity and work. Yes, you have a question.
Are there many or other organizations or businesses that really hone in on that work in other occupations?
In agriculture, there are a lot through the AgrAbility program, the USDA AgrAbility program.
Right.
But outside of agriculture, there are not.
Okay.
There are not many resources for a tradesman or a worker who doesn't want to sit in an office. We wouldn't take an accountant and say, now you really need to get retrained to go and be a welder. But we're pretty quick to tell a welder, you need to go get retrained and maybe you can design web pages or do social media. And that person was a welder because that's what he enjoyed, has the skill at, has been trained in.
Has a license.
So there is a social and cultural aspect that is being missed in many of the assistive technology evaluations with the tradespeople. So that's where we are trying to bring that into the conversation and identify assistive technology to really help these people continue their work.
Besides AgrAbility, is there anything else in ag?
Besides AgrAbility, is there anything else
in ag to help?
In agriculture?
Yes.
No, AgrAbility is the main organization that would help workers with disabilities. There are a lot of organizations and training materials for farm safety, but that would not specifically be for someone with a disability. So now we start moving into the general farm data information, the worksite situation, and this is going to help us look at the activities. So now we're thinking about the activities. It's going to depend a lot on the situation that the worker is in. Business information. Is the work site, it's the context also. Rough terrain, spread out buildings. Some of those pictures we looked at, you could tell were very large operations, large distances. Others, there's greenhouse, workshop, and it's all very close. Working in the shop, doing maintenance, using tools, hand tools, how heavy are they? Is it heated for year-round use? Are they safe? But just understanding, does this person do it or not? The equipment and the machinery, tall machinery, small machinery, do you use it all the time? Once in a while, we need to know a lot of specifics, really, the makes and models of the equipment that we're using, how many steps up, what kind of controls are there, is there a lever way down by the floor that needs to be reached down? Maybe only twice a year do you have to hit the differential lock lever to get out of a sticky spot, but if you don't have it and you get stuck, all at once it becomes important. So we ask these questions about the controls. We ask about the seats. Does a seat swivel? Does it bounce? Are the cushions in good condition? So a lot of details here that we ask about. What crops are you producing? Where do you market them? Does it apply to you? So orchards, we're going to be in a very different situation than someone growing vegetables. Woodlots. That's a question on here for a reason, because many people in rural areas are heating their homes with firewood. And we might not think of that right away as part of their employment, except it might be $5,000 worth that otherwise they would have to earn that money to buy fuel oil. So we need to make sure to ask about the woodlots. What about the lawn and garden? Might not matter. It might be, oh, that's my wife's thing. Or it might be a place of healing, psychological, just quietness. Many of the veterans that we work with have PTSD, and they need a quiet, safe place. So it's all part of the context. The management. Who's keeping the books? Are they computerized? Are you making a living wage here? Or are you mortgaging the farm? Are you going deeper and deeper in debt? Is this what you want to be doing long term? Is there anything else that you enjoy? Any other work enterprises that we could think about with you? We're asking some really big picture questions in this interview so that we are recommending technology that is going to really serve their need. If the business is going out next year, what are they going to do next? Maybe we can come up with technology to work for this next year and then still be useful after that for other activities. Finally, as we work through this, and we understand their training, we understand if they were a veteran, that's important for funding questions. There might be other avenues of being able to pay for assistive technology for veterans, or somebody that has a pension, or someone that's got workers' comp insurance. There was one person who was a farmer and an accountant, and her professional organization as an accountant helped support her with her disability. So we get to our primary goals, what matters to this person, and we come up with our plan. So after we go through all the experiences, education, talk to the person about what their primary goals are. What do you really want to accomplish? Finally, we get to the assistive technology. This is where we want to jump to first, but we get here last. We can develop a plan, we can research the technology, and come up with really good solutions, but we have to do it in this order. Person, context, activity. Finally, good technology, good assistive technology that will be used and make a difference in the person's life. Give them the independence at work so they can provide for their family, so they can afford the leisure. Help them get back to work so they can go sailing, right? And we have those abilities. So, do you have any questions or comments about this as you think about your roles in helping people with disabilities keep doing their work?
How long should this process take from initial interview to actually getting to technology?
It's going to vary a lot on the person. We might need to set up multiple appointments, have a conversation with the worker, and then say, let's talk about this with your family. Can we come to the site and see the environment? So it might be a 6-month process from initial conversation till we get to the point of actually recommending and finding funding for the technology. But we're really doing a life situation evaluation here of looking at the really big picture. It's not just throwing a wheelchair at somebody. It's helping them plan for a productive, healthy, quality life going forward. Okay. Thank you very much.